For the final time this season, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hello and welcome to the Football Revolution. I'm your host, Gio. Thanks for joining us. Here we go. Olé, olé, olé. Hola to everyone. Hello, in honour of football mad Argentina winning the World Cup. And joining me, my teammate, welcome, Killingham VIG. G'day, mate. How's it going?
Buenas noches. How are you going?
Mate, you have to always show me up.
Look, I've been watching videos of Argentina fans celebrating all day, so it's the least I could do is pick up a bit of the language.
All right, mate, everything good with you? So I know that the sleepless nights are coming to an end, even though we've got a lot more football and everything, but everything going good?
Yeah, all good. I've been up since 1:30 a.m. this morning, so running on pure adrenaline, but what a day to be alive. What a football match this morning with the World Cup final. After you know a bit of a downer in the A-League across the weekend, so nothing like you know a way to pick up your spirits and get back in the swing of things.
I was going to say, for every bit of magic that we've experienced in Qatar, the A-League's doing the reverse of it. So lots of problems here, and that's our game, right? So we're going to have to just get stuck into it and try and fix it. But look, obviously the major news and the massive black eye for football in this country happened in Melbourne on Saturday night. Absolutely disgraceful and not something accepted on the sporting field in our country. I was in Melbourne, but decided not to take my family to the game. Thank the Lord. I decided not to go there. Something told me not to go. And I was thinking maybe the fans just walk out in the 20th minute, but it was a lot worse than that. And all football fans were hoping the World Cup success would charge our league. But instead of that, the worst publicity for our game, and we found it. Whatever was the worst way of promoting our game after that amazing World Cup's journey, not only for the Socceroos but for all teams involved, and we've gone backwards.
Yeah, look, it was just a sad day for Australian football. Like you said, there must have been a messiah out there that sent you a message to stay away from that ground on Saturday night. Just a shocking turn of events. And when I think about it, like you peel the layers back. It started with the APL, their decision during the week to announce that the next three grand finals will be in Sydney. The fans' outrage, I understand that. We totally understand that. We get that. And, the protest to leave a football match 20 minutes in, it made sense. That they wanted to make a point. We saw it happen at other games throughout the weekend, happened in Wellington, the Jets and... that was it. That the fans, they made their point, and we understand. And look, I know the Victory fans and the City fans and Melbourne in particular, they feel very strongly about this topic. So I could understand, a few flares on the field. It wasn't really getting out of control until, Tommy Glover does pick up a flare and throw it back into the crowd. And I'm not excusing the events that took place after that, but that did stoke the fire a little bit. And what happened after that was just, I think, a build-up of emotion and frustration. And yes, it only takes one or two idiots to absolutely turn this into an absolute catastrophe, which is what happened. And what happened once the fans stormed the pitch and picked up the sand bucket and threw it at the player and put the players in danger, that's disgraceful. We can't see that happen in our game. We can't let that happen again. And as football fans, as people that love the game, we can't keep doing this to ourselves. We can't keep. These people need to be banned from football matches. They need tighter security. They shouldn't. Some of these people shouldn't have been let in the first place. But yeah, it's just bitterly disappointing after the momentum that we built off the World Cup, such a success for the Socceroos and for Australian football. And then to come back here and to just demolish our own game, it's just it's heartbreaking. It's quite sad in a way.
Yeah, look, touching on a few of your points, VIG. So look, Tom Glover didn't deserve what happened to him, and we wish him all the best shaking this drama off. But one of the lessons learned from this is, if let's flick the flares. That's first and foremost. Okay, they're great, but they're dangerous. If that had hit one of the hit Tom Glover, or if he hit one of the fans when he'd thrown it back in, it would have been a lot worse. So first, let's get rid of the flares. But second of all, let the ground staff handle these incidents, not the players, right? You don't need to take things into your own hands. Tom Glover's there to play the game. Unfortunately, as a result, he's got a lot harsher punishment than he totally deserved, but he should have just left that to to the officials. And look, that's not to say for any stretch of the imagination he deserved anything or even close to what he got. He shouldn't have had anything for what his troubles were. But look, he should definitely have just left it alone. And on top of that, you know, this is not the first football game we've ever hosted in this country. So after we've had an incident like we have, and that's not to excuse for 1 second in exactly what's happened and how upset the fans are, they're totally separate topics. But after you've put them in a blender and shook them upright, surely you know there's some clowns out there that do their own thing. So there has to be a lot tighter security. You can't just have guys jumping over the fence, right, and letting them do what they want. You know, those couple of idiots that were running onto the pitch, banging their chests like they're, you know, Braveheart and that, they need a good hard look at themselves in the mirror and realise that, you know, they've wrecked this game and brought the game into disrepute. And like I said, this is not a little thing that just, you know, a little schoolyard mistake or something you do down the pub with your mates. This has affected whole of football in Australia. You know, this has gone globally now, and then every single person that doesn't follow football is trying to now jump on the bandwagon and say it's a hooligan sport and all this. No, there's a fantastic sport, as was shown by the World Cup with Morocco's story and Croatia's story and all the families. And, you know, you can't get stories like that in any other sport in the world, almost in any other walk of life in the world. So it's not to say that, you know, that we've got big problems, you know, in the game throughout. We do. We have problems. But, yeah, that was just a one-off thing that needs to be stamped out. I think the victory handled it very well. I think, you know, that the reporters are trying to say to him, oh, do you think Tom Glover kind of deserved what he got? And she distanced herself very much and said, no, he didn't. It's got nothing to do with what Tom Glover did. I disagree with that. I think, like I said, he did stoke the fire, like you said, but totally didn't deserve it. And, you know, like I said, if he hadn't have thrown the flare back, who knows what would have happened, but there's no crystal ball. So, look, let's try and put this behind us. I don't know what we get out of this talking about this over and over and over again, but it was very, very, very disappointing. And, you know, especially when you're looking at, you know, what happened with the Socceroos as well as young football fans in this country, I don't want them watching that. You know what I mean? It's not safe taking your families to that. And who knows, it may take us two steps backwards now, but it's nothing less than we deserve for basically the performance that was put on from football fans on the weekend.
Yeah, look, you know, there's places in Europe that have, you know, the ultras or the sections behind the goals are literally fenced off. So, like, they literally cannot throw flares onto the pitch, or they cannot, you know, enter the field of play. You know, if we're going to have to start doing that, you know, I don't want to see it. We shouldn't have to do that. But if this is what we have to do, if we want that active support behind the goal, and we want them to create an atmosphere, we want them to, you know, bring a bit of colour to the game, we're going to have to literally lock them away like caged animals and keep them behind, you know, a fence or a barbed wire or a drop-down sheet. So, look, we don't really want to see that happen, but we need active support. And the, you know, APL and Football Australia need to work with these people. They need to, you know, engage with them. Keep them happy and listen to what they have to say, because the fans are an extremely important part of this game, and we need the fans at football matches. We saw, you know, the day after in the Western United Western Sydney game, look, there was literally almost no one there, and the game was boring. It was dull. It was a dull affair. We need fans in this game. We need to keep the fans happy, but we can't have stupidity. The you know, the minority, the 1, 2, 3 idiots that rock up to a football match and ruin the game, they need to go. They need to be banned. They need to be far away from the game. But in saying that, we need fans at the game, and we need to treat the fans with respect, and we need to work with them to make sure that they come week in, week out. They don't disrespect the league, and you know, we bring more fans into the game as well.
You know, we say to the APL, let's hope they clean this up. But also another message for them: don't treat the football fans as dumb. Or the players going out there and putting out releases and that, and hoping that, you know, it's like, you know, working at a company and saying to everyone, you're going to get a pay decrease this year, and then not telling anyone, and then sending out videos of everyone saying, yeah, this is fantastic, can't wait to get 10,000 less in my pay packet next week. Surely everyone knows that no one would have said that. So don't go out there and do that. I don't know why you show disrespect to the players there. There's no cross lines there. You've asked, you know, you've put Craig Goodwin in the firing line and caused problems for him with his fan base and his following in Adelaide. You've done it with other female players as well as saying that all the clubs had agreed to it. Well, I'm pretty sure they would have known if they'd agreed to it or not. So I don't know whose message it was. Surely someone there puts their hand up and says, hey, I think what we're doing here is wrong. And that's not obviously a reason for what happened on the weekend, but what they did was totally wrong, and they should have basically consulted the fans. Even if you're going to make a decision that's best for the game, great, but at least give them the courtesy of saying, hey, we don't think you're idiots. This is what we're going to be doing, and letting the clubs funnel that down to the fans as well, and to the players, and doing it the right way. We just did it like an absolute the tail leading the donkey, and that's not the way we want it being done here. But look, let's hope it's onward and upwards from here, and that the people that did the wrong thing are held accountable, and that we can try and get things back on track as soon as possible, and, you know, not forget about it, but learn from it. So another aftermath of this was Victory chairman Anthony DiPietro resigns from the APL board. Apparently he voted for the venue of the new final being in Sydney for 3 years and then flipped when the fans were outraged. So that's another example of someone who I'm not sure if he just went with the grain. You know, he went with the swell and got floated along, but then all I realized, hey, this is not the right thing. But he should have, you know, he should have stood up earlier and done something about it rather than wait until the fans tell him what was happening, because that was guaranteed. I could have bet you a 1,000,000% that that's what the fans were going to vote for if you'd given the fans any heads up what was happening beforehand. So that's another disappointing thing. Add to that more bad news for the league. Raw star Charlie Austin played his last game returning home to the UK this week as well. So, you know, he said he's enjoyed his time here. I think it was a little bit strange that he's left his daughter to sit at HSC or whatever, and the rest of the family's come out here and then realised that he shouldn't have done that, and he should have looked after his family first. And, you know, like I say, better late than never. But I just think it's really strange. One of the two big stars we bring out, Nanny one and obviously Charlie Austin two, has flipped on a 2-year deal when at the moment we need all the stars and all the support we can get. So that was a bit strange, but we wish him all the best back in the UK, and we hope we can get some other big names come out and replace him.
Yeah, look, it's a shame. You know, you always want when a big player that's played at the highest level, played in the Premier League, scored lots of goals in the Premier League, comes out to our league. We want to embrace that. You know, we could see what he does to the younger players, that the standards he sets, what he demands as a footballer, and what he demands of each player and of the club. So, you know, it's a shame to see him go back, but we wish him all the very best. And if it's for family reasons, like we always say on this show, family first and football second. So good luck to him, and we wish him all the best.
Look, some positive news finally. Socceroo Adam Taggart signs a 3.5-year deal to return to Oz with the Perth Glory. Excellent signing for the club, and definitely some good news that we needed this week with everything that's happened. But let's stop harping on the negatives and move forward. Another World Cup is in the can with two great semi-finals. Croatia claims third and Argentina claimed the Holy Grail with a 6-goal thriller followed by penalties against France. We'll touch on that a lot more in our World Cup top 10 and our World Cup final Pele Awards edition. We wrap up match day 5 of the A-League women's competition, an unusual revolutionised roundup to follow. It's sadly our last edition of our World Cup Pele Awards. We find out who wins our head-to-head, me or VIG, plus we hand out our awards. Is there anything I didn't see, VIG?
Well, I don't know. Did you see Messi lift the trophy this morning? Because he was wearing a Harry Potter invisibility cloak. So
I thought that was one of the lingerie sets. I thought I've seen some lingerie.
Victoria's Secret.
I was looking for my missus. Yeah, I thought maybe he'd stolen it from one of them. But if it had colour, it would have been Joseph in the Technicolor Dreamcoat. I'm not sure if I've ever seen, as good as he is, and he could be the best of all time, I don't think I've ever seen a captain dressed in different clothes to the rest of his team, then walk through like he's the king. But it's happened. There's nothing we can do about it now. And if anyone deserves it, it's probably him. But if I was a teammate, I'd be thinking, what's going on here?
Oh, honestly, he's too nice a bloke, Messi, because if that was me about to lift the World Cup trophy and some blokes put a black, I don't know, see-through lingerie cloak on me, mate, I would not be having it. It's going to be one of the most iconic photos in the history of football, right? And poor Messi's got this lingerie cloak on that, I don't know, you get in the hotel room, you know, they've got him sitting in the cupboard in a hotel room with a pair of slippers.
I think you might have hit the nail on the head. He was hoping it was the Harry Potter invisibility cloak, so no one saw him.
Yeah, I think Ronaldo requested the invisibility cloak, so he didn't have to see Messi lift the trophy. So,
All right, there is no player escape room this week, but we plan to get the players back in after the holidays. So, they get a few weeks off or a few weeks break from the football revolution, but they'll be back and better than ever in the new year. A-League women's wrap. You ready for this? We'll smash through this considering we've got so much to get through on the show.
Let's go.
Paul Wellington still searching for a point. Let another game slip away as Mackenzie Barry own goal gifts Adelaide another victory. Not an A-League classic, but a first half Holly Palmer goal showed the Wanderers how to get the job done and leaves Kate Smith's team going back to the drawing board. In the Melbourne Derby, undefeated heavyweight battle, a Hilary Beale penalty save with the score tied at 1-1, followed by a double to Matilda Chloe Lagazzo, was enough to keep Western United top of the table and undefeated. American defender Kayla Morrison helped herself to a hat-trick, and Molina airs a brace as the Victory recorded their third win in a row, easing past the Jets 5-2 to move up to fifth. And in the final game of the round, Perth Glory with an impressive comeback from two goals down to snatch a 3-2 win thanks to two goals from Riley Basden to help Canberra to their first defeat of the season, or to hand Canberra their first defeat of the season. So a quick snapshot of the A-League women's table. Red hot Western United are the only remaining undefeated teams as they beat rival City as well as Canberra, losing a last-ditch one to the Glory. So our top four is Western United sitting on 12, Adelaide sitting on 12, Melbourne City sitting on 9, and Sydney FC, who had the week off, sitting on 9. And just behind them in fifth and sixth, even though it's only a top four, is Melbourne Victory on 9 and the Brisbane Roar on 7.
Yeah, look, the big story of the weekend is Western United, the new girls on the block, beating City, who have been saying almost untouchable in the last few weeks. So huge victory, huge statement, and some nice goals from Chloe Legazzo.
Yeah, most certainly. All right, so my weekly rap has been replaced by a shout-out dedicating a weekly song to a team or player for their good or bad performance. This week's shout-out is a no-brainer. It goes to Lionel Messi, Emiliano Martinez, and the Argentinian team. Congrats to all involved. And the song we send to them is Queen's, the song Don't Stop Me Now. Because I'm having a good time. Now, if you know the lyrics, I'm having a good time. They don't want to be stopped. They are absolutely on fire at the moment. Martinez was brilliant. Messi showed why he is possibly the GOAT, you know, the greatest of all time. And there were some other star players. I think there was a couple of boys in midfield as well as their young is it Enzo?
Enzo Fernandez.
Who was the young player of the tournament as well. So, in the footsteps of Queen, don't stop us now. We're having a great time and they hope this party goes on for another few months.
They are good. I'll tell you, he couldn't stop. It was Kun Aguero getting in with the celebrations after the match. I'll tell you what, if you didn't know any different, you would have thought he played every minute of every match of the tournament and was the top goal scorer because he was celebrating hard, but he does deserve it. It's a shame that he wasn't there and he wasn't playing, but it's great to see him in and around the group and really lifting the vibes in the group.
Look, if I'd known that all you have to do is ask Messi to be one of your children's godparent, I would have sent Messi plenty of emails over the last 15 years saying, hey, mate, my kids would love you to be their godparent because it seems like Aguero was able to get out on the pitch without any questions asked. He was able to do pretty much have all access anywhere where he wanted to go. And look, I know he's also was married to and has had a child with Maradona's daughter, so he is already football royalty, but it doesn't matter doubling down, right, and having the good old Messi as one of your godparents as well. So he's a smart shopper. Not only was he brilliant on the pitch, but he's shown off the pitch. He's just as astute and making sure he's still part of all the excitement for Argentina. All right, so moving on to the A-League men's table. It's Melbourne City on 16, Wanderers on 14, Adelaide on 12, Macarthur have moved up to fourth on 11, Central Coast on 10, and rounding out the top six is the Wellington Phoenix on 10. A lot happened, obviously, with an abandoned game and some upsets and that sorts of things, but we'll touch on those in the game. So just for the listeners at home, quick snapshot of how we review each game each week. It's the score, the goal scorers, the players of the game, the turning point, and what we would have changed, Coach Gio or VIG, to try and get a result for the losing team or to try and get more than 1 point for either of the teams if they had a draw. So the first game was Newcastle versus Brisbane Roar, which was on the Friday. The score was 1-0 to the away team Brisbane Roar. The goal coming in the 80th minute, not the cleanest. So he had a shot which was saved, and while he was on the ground, instead of doing a bit of yoga or something, he decided he'd strike his leg out again and hit the ball into the back of net. It was Milanusic with the winner in the 80th minute. For me, the player of the game was Jordan Holmes. He made a nice save, I think about the 90-something minute in stoppage time, a nice save onto the post to keep the Roar in the lead, as well as he also ended the day with a clean sheet. I think there was some other good performers. Obviously, Captain Courageous at the back, Tommy Aldred, was fantastic for them. I think Amaretto was also really good, I think, until he got an injury during the game. But I think for me, Jordan Holmes was a big reason why they walked away with all 3 points. The turning point for me was when Angus Thurgate's effort cannoned off the crossbar in the opening minutes. I'm not sure if you saw that, but it was a really well-struck chance. I think at the moment the Jets seem to be really fragile. They need things going their way. They are very inconsistent, and I think if they'd gone up 1-0 against the Brisbane team, who, you know, were obviously up for a big game considering they were saying goodbye to their big star, Charlie Austin, I think they were ready for the game, but I think it would have changed things if they'd fallen behind and then started chasing their tails. So I think that was definitely the turning point for me in the game. And the thing that I would have changed is the Jets need to change some combinations. They need to start looking at something different and go back to the drawing board. I think it's not working what's happening. They put a team out on paper and you look and you think, wow, what a fantastic lineup when you look at the two Beckers and you're looking at Brandon O'Neill and Thurgate, and, you know, and the list goes on and on and on. But they get out there, they have 65% possession, they have 7 shots on goal, 2 only on target, whereas a team like the Roar was starved of the ball with a minimal 35% of the ball, but they had 18 shots with 6 on target and they end up winning the game 1-0. So I don't think the Jets are doing enough with the ball. I don't think the combinations are working. So just having great players next to each other is not working for the Jets. And like I said, I'm just really disappointed in what they're putting out on the pitch week in, week out. The lineups are good, but there's no consistency there. And for a team that has that quality of player and they've now had 2 transfer windows to get it right, they're nowhere near where they need to be or anywhere where they need to be to be pushing for silverware.
Yeah, look, so sometimes when you don't have the players, you know, maybe they're putting too much emphasis on actually having the ball and keeping the ball and not being able to really penetrate and to get into good goal-scoring positions. So, you know, we saw with the World Cup final, 2 teams that don't necessarily always want the ball in France and Argentina, and teams that, you know, prefer to sit back and you know, have a bit of a low block and then get teams on the counter. And, you know, maybe a change in you know, the way Newcastle play or the thinking, you know, potentially to not have to have the ball so much. It seems weird to say because, you know, we always say possession in football, but sometimes when you have players that can get in behind, and sometimes you need to drag the opposition out to be able to find that space in behind and get in behind. So, you know, maybe a change in formation or a change in personnel as well. But a little bit disappointing from the Jets. But in saying that, Brisbane were good. You said Jordan Holmes had a tremendous game, and fitting way to send out Charlie Austin.
Look, Dave. And this is no disrespect to the Roar, but it's probably a massive compliment to Moon, is the fact that they don't have anywhere near the cattle, and I don't think they would have spent anywhere near the money the Jets have spent on players in the last 2 years, but still you've got a team who's gone out there and done the job. So I think they need to go and watch Spain and realise having the ball doesn't win you the game, and they need to go watch someone like Morocco from the World Cup, which is just current and relevant, and say, hey, when you're direct, doesn't matter how much of the ball you have, you could have 2 chances, you can score 2 goals, but having 65% of the possession and only 2 shots on target is not good enough, and you're not going to win any games. And as seen, you don't get points for having 65%, 80% of the ball or passing accuracy of 75% or better. So definitely some work needs to be done there for the Jets if they want to be serious contenders or even in the 6 this year. Moving on to the second game, which was the first of the 3 Saturday games. It was the Wellington Phoenix at home against Adelaide United. How did you see this one, BIG?
Well, what a game. And, you know, the final score was 3-1 to Wellington. The goal scorers in the second, Zawada. In the 12th, Craig Goodwin with an absolute peach of a free kick. Fantastic. Probably one of the goals of the season, up where the Spiders live. Kraev for Wellington in 37th.
And he's then, the silent assassin, Kraev.
He is. He's just chipping away.
Every single week, just quietly going about his business, the Bulgarian. Very, very likable, and a fantastic signing from Wolfuck and the Phoenix.
He is. And then to complete it in the 61st, Jan Sussi, I think his name is. So. And he was my player of the match as well, the Brazilian. Unfortunately, he was sent off in this fixture earlier on in the season, received the red card in the first half. So I think he had a bit of a point to prove, and he was out there to sort of make amends for that game. And he hasn't been too crash hot since he's come back and played a few games. So I just like the way he went about his business. He added a bit of dynamism to Wellington. And, you know, with the 2 up top in Kraev and Zawada scoring goals, you know, it makes life a lot easier.
Well, it's a great way for him to get redemption. And not only that, I think it's another way of showing that if you play the players in the right positions and the right combinations, even with limited resources, you can get results in this league.
Yeah, definitely. And look, the turning point for me, obviously the Ben Haller and red card in the 51st. I know Wellington were 2-1 up at the time, but that just pretty much, you know, killed it off for Adelaide.
Hard job, more hard.
It did. It made it difficult away from home. You know, it was raining. They just couldn't really find their way back into the game after that. And then obviously 10 minutes later they cop another goal to go 3-1 down. So it was pretty much done and dusted by then. You know, what would I have changed if I was Carl Viet? Not much, if I was honest. It was just one of those days for Adelaide. They got caught, you know, caught on the back foot right at the start with a goal again in the second minute. And then, you know, the unfortunate red card killed the game. Maybe if I was Viet, maybe perhaps he makes a double change straight after the goal. You bring on Iran Kunda and maybe another attacker, maybe potentially Blackwood. And I don't know how fit Nick Antal is, if he's, you know, fit enough to play 90 minutes, but maybe a player with his experience from the start. You know, young Popovich got caught out a little bit for that first goal and slightly for the second goal as well with the ball over the top. So, you know, potentially a couple of personnel changes for Viet, but, you know, I think it was just one of those days for Adelaide. After the Craig Goodwin goal, not much went well for him.
All right, moving on to the second of the Saturday games. It was the Central Coast Mariners versus Sydney FC. The Mariners have a really, really good record against the Sky Blues, the Bling Blings. But again, they've been fortunate enough to get a 2-1 victory here. Mariners, the home team, running out 2-1 victors. The goals were Sydney taking an early lead in the 11th through Paolo Retre. Central Coast equalising in the 36th through Marco Tullio, so their version of our Australian star. And then 3 minutes later, a Dan Hall goal in the 39th minute, giving them the 2-1 win. For me, the player of the match was Dan Hall. He was safe at the back, plus the winning goal. That was just icing on the cake. And I think, you know, he had some great support around him with Vukovic and the likes. And I think there was a lot of good workers and guys that put in great shifts for the Mariners, as they usually do, to ensure that they're more fancied big brothers. They put them to bed and got another 3 points out of them, which seems to be a bogey team for Sydney. But, yeah, a great win for the Mariners. The turning point for me would have been Sydney having a siesta for a few minutes just before half time. So you've taken a 1-0 lead. You've got you know, a lot of firepower on the pitch with Lolly and Mac, and you know, and you've got a real lot of firepower at your disposal here. And you've taken a well earned lead, but then you concede two goals in the space of 3 minutes. You know, less than 10 minutes before half time, and then that was pretty much too much for you to handle. And then all of a sudden, you know, I don't know if it was just because there is a strong rivalry there, or if the Mariners have got the wood over Sydney, or maybe it's to do with what's happening in the league, but there was a big bust up at the end of the game and the fire, you know, a bit of fire and stuff, which I don't mind, but it wasn't needed. It wasn't another great look for the A-League. And, you know, like I said, at the moment we're trying to do things that make people want to come to the game, but watching that didn't make me do that. It makes me think of those cheap rugby league games when you see guys go and start bashing each other and fight on for no reason. There was no real reason in. I think Donaghy's tackle wasn't great. He got one in return. He seems to be at the moment a guy just, you can just breathe on him and he wants to go in there and start. It's about the third time now I've seen him go in there, and I love the way he supports his teammates, but he's just got to realise unless something major happens and you're going into bat there, this is just a little tit-for-tat squabble, right? You don't need to keep coming in over the top, mate, every single time. So just back off, take it easy, because it's not a great look for the league, and especially with what we're going through at the moment. And the final thing for me would have been, what I would have changed is, I'm not liking Sydney's 4-3-3. I'm glad they found room for Burgess, who we talked about. You know, he was excellent against Celtic, and he was really great last week as well. But I prefer him playing, you know, instead of a 4-3-3, I'd prefer him playing, you know, 3-4-3, or even if they're playing a 3-5-2 or something. They've got such good players.
4-2-3-1 or something like that.
Yeah, at the moment, I just don't think that having the four at the back, I think you've got two good wing backs. Ryan Grant has forgotten how to get forward, and I think it's probably because of the fact that he's not getting the opportunities because he's blocked. And then you've also got, is it Caballo on the other side as well? He's brought in as supposed to be an attacking player. Well, when you've got four at the back, I don't think you're really using those guys as wingbacks, right? So I'd much prefer to see these guys, you know, getting up and around and creating some service for these guys. At the moment, I think Sydney, and you said last week you thought they were the team that was the most impressive when they come back, but they're very one-dimensional. You know, they're relying on Mac and Lolly and these guys making, you know, runs by themselves. Bratton was good on the weekend. He hit a fantastic volley that he was unlucky with, that, you know, rattled the crossbar and had beaten Vuker all ends up. And I think later on in the game, he get called on Vuker again down low. So, look, I think, you know, he's good. But at the moment, it's not really a team performance. Maybe last week was a one-off, but I think there's no team performance there. It's just good players going out there and trying to get a result against the Mariners team, who it's all for one, one for all. So I think that's the key.
Yeah, look, I said last week I wanted to see Max Burgess a little bit more central. And like you said, with when Sydney are at their best, their left and right backs are getting forward, they're explosive, they're creating lots of chances. And normally, you know, we're used to Sydney playing that 4-2-2-2 with a real narrow midfield and narrow up top, and that allows your wing backs to get forward. So I don't know, maybe they go back to something like that, and that allows a player like, you know, Max Burgess to come in. But the problem with Sydney at the moment is I think they have too many players of the same type. So they're finding it a little bit difficult to fit all pieces in the puzzle. So, you know, potentially one of them has to miss out. You know, it happened to Victory earlier in the season. Popovich was dropping Brimmer, and Connor Meadies was on the bench. Now Falami's finding himself on the bench. So, it's just finding that right combination, and I think Sydney are struggling a little bit with that at the moment.
And the final game of Saturday's games was the Melbourne Derby, which was supposed to be an absolute cracking game. Instead, it turned into an absolute farcical. So the score was 1-0 when the game was abandoned in the 20-odd minute after an Aidan O'Neill had given the home side the lead. For me, I'm going to abandon.
What a goal! By the way, like it was a great goal. If you're Aidan O'Neill, you're absolutely kicking yourself that game's been cancelled and the events that took part after that. So
there's a million other reasons why the league will be kicking themselves as well as the clubs. But unfortunately, the game was abandoned. I think I've said enough about it in the opening to say that I'm going to abandon my Revolution Roundup of this game. I'm just curious. I had one question before we move on, unless you've got more you want to add to it, VIG, is what happens to the fans? Do you get your money back? Do you get free passes? Do you get to go meet the players? Do you get a free hot dog? What happens now? Like, do you just get 20 minutes worth of football after spending $100-something on the family? You sit down with your food, so you've probably spent $200 on it around Christmas time when you're probably struggling for a little bit of cash, and now what are you going to do? Just blow your money, just burn it?
Yeah, I don't know. Look, if the game is going to be played again or continued from the 21st minute mark, whenever it stopped, will it be played behind closed doors? I think it has to be. I don't think they can have fans in for that fixture now. But like you said, what happens to the fans that paid money to go there on Saturday night, expecting to see a great football match, which they did for 21 minutes. The football was of a high quality. There was a great goal. There was some great passages of play. And to have it ruined in the way that it was, it's just disappointing. Like, I can't vent my frustration enough about the events that took place. And, you know, just quietly, I'm sick of talking. I'm sick of talking to my mates about it. I'm sick of texting people about it. You know, the culprits need to be dealt with. They need to be banned, and they need to be kept far away from our game.
Look, if they want any advice on how they should reimburse or, you know, treat the fans for who wasted their time going out there, just give the Football Revolution a call. We've got good customer service. Don't go to Medibank Private or one of those guys who had all their data stolen and they offer you nothing. They don't say, hey, here's 3 months worth of thing. They send you all the emails saying, we're so sorry. We really apologise for what happened for you. Here's a number to call if you're stressed. How about just giving me 3 months worth of free healthcare. Insurance. Yeah, healthcare. Now, considering that you've put us through all this stress, if you really are concerned about me, put your money where your mouth is. Don't say, oh, yeah, we're really sorry, call this number, which 800 other people are probably calling, so I'll never get through. So if the A-League wants some advice, give something out. Give something back in return here. You've cost these guys their time and their money. Give them something in return. So moving on to the two Sunday games. The first one was Western United versus the Wanderers. What happened here, VIG?
Not much after the fifth minute, to be honest. Full time was 1-0 to Western United. Goal in the fifth to Prijevic. It was a bit of a stalemate, a bit of a chess game. Bit of a slow burner.
Massive relief for Western United to have Prijevic back in the lineup and scoring.
Yeah, massive relief. It was a lovely assist from Troisi, I think. So. And a great finish. He's taken it on his chest, and just a bit of class that the league needs. And it's massive to have him back. But for me, my player of the match was Jamie Young. He made some important saves, kept a clean sheet. None other than which was my turning point in the 55th, I think. the Wanderers were starting to assert themselves in the match. They were starting to get forward and create a few chances. And Jamie Young pulls out a save against Kerpich when he's through, but he just makes it look so easy. He stuck the left hand out and the ball's just popped up back into his arms. But I think that's a tremendous save given the circumstances and the timing of the game as well. So
important ingredient in the champions run last year. But surely if the Wanderers want to be serious contenders this year against the champions team who is struggling and on the ropes, you need to put them to sleep. I know you might be away, but if you've brought in the players they have and they have a really good lineup, really balanced lineup, and they've had some really good results, I know it's the second game back after the World Cup break, but you need to be able to put one on their chin and knock them out, right? You can't be walking away with a nil-one, great, good performance, doesn't get your points.
Yeah, absolutely, and they had their chances, and that was a massive chance for the Wanderers to go top of the table as well, and top of the league, and really assert themselves at the top there, and build off that. It's a massive opportunity miss, but I tell you what, Diamante, when he comes on with about 15 to go, he's all class. The game shifted again at that point, and he took control of the game. He's a lovely footballer. He's a player that can really change the tempo of a game and dictate the play. And he's a joy to watch. And we need him back. We need him to stay fit and playing week in, week out, and hopefully starting matches soon.
Mate, he's so good. I'd be even happy to change the games to 15 minutes a half if it means we get Dia Magic back on the pitch every week.
Absolutely.
He's just a wizard.
Absolutely. And look, what I would have changed from this match, if I'm Marco Rodan, the 4-4-2 he's gone with, I'm playing a 4-3-3 or a 4-2-1-3. I'm getting Enga Bokoto and Borello up a bit higher, and Amalfitano in behind Kerpich up top, and then you've got Bozanic and Neuenhoff in midfield as your anchors. So I just don't think they put enough pressure on the Western back line. And they were a bit timid, I think, the Wanderers. They didn't really, have a real crack at this one and try and get something out of the match after going 1-0 down at the start.
Mate, I think a lot of these teams in the A-League this year can go and watch what Argentina did at the World Cup. Not only did they win it, but the way that the coach changed things around, bringing Dia Maria in for the final, who'd been out for all the knockout stages and had the desired result. It's a matter of picking a team week in, week out, different formations, different situations, and making sure you're ready. You can't just have one game plan or one lineup or one thing. He changed it 3 or 4 times. There was a lot of people, questioning what he was doing, but it's worked out really well for him because of the fact that he had a plan and he stuck to it. So I think that's great feedback for all the other A-League coaches. So the last game of the round was the MacArthur Bulls at home against Perth Glory. The final score was 1-0 to MacArthur Bulls. The goal coming from Arabuli in the 71st minute. It was the Georgians' first goal for the club, so probably a little bit overdue. I think when you bring in a player, especially an attacking player, expect to get a good return pretty early on. So he's had to wait until after the World Cup break for him to be able to get that goal. But it was still a goal that was important for them to take all 3 points against an improving Glory side. For me, the player of the match was young Keegan Jelicic. So he was in a losing team, but I think everything good and everything the commentator was saying that was positive out of Perth was coming from this young player. I think he's only 20 years of age, and he showed why he's definitely a young talent, and hopefully the Glory can hold on to him. The way he played and the way he's starting to play, if he can string some games together and put a nice CV together this year, I think the other A-League clubs can become knocking. But I'm hoping, obviously, that the Glory signing Taggart to replace Hare Fornaroli goes to show that they are serious about rebuilding this team and making them a force again. So hopefully they hold on to him and we see some more great play from him in the coming weeks. The turning point for me was Ryan Williams. He was sensational the week before, hence why and we'll touch on this in TFR Fantasy. I brought him into my fantasy team, but he blazed over from 8 yards at 0-0. I think for a player of his calibre and the form he's in, I think that's something that he should have definitely hit the target here. And if he'd hit the target, I think it would have gone in. It was just too close a range, but unfortunately he blazed over. And I think that was pretty much an indication of how the Glory's afternoon was going to pan out. And for me, what I would have done or changed if in that game was the Glory were good again, but I can't stand their 5-4-1. I don't know why you bring David Williams back in, and like I said, it's been a few years since he's played in the A-League. You put a player like that who's been out of the league a long time playing, I think he's been in the Indian League, which is a big difference to...
No, they've put him on an island at the top of the pitch by himself.
Well, they have, but I don't understand with the way they played last week and the young players they have coming through, why they've gone and played a 5-4-1. And I think they had the better of the game against MacArthur Bulls, but it didn't show in the stats. They didn't have more possession. They didn't actually have any real good goal-scoring chances, even though they got themselves into dangerous positions. So for me, I just thought it was very negative from Zakovic's team when they were excellent last week and they had a real good opportunity to string two good, you know, wins together, and instead they've blown their lines. So hopefully, like I said, they learn from this and they put in a more complete performance this week. But that's the end of our Revolutionised Roundup. Up after the break, it's our final World Cup review, our top 10 and Pele Awards for the season. But we'll catch you after the break.
You're listening to the Football Revolution.
Welcome back to the show. It's our final edition of the World Cup, our top 10, our Pele Awards. So exciting and disappointing at the same time. We'll give out our winners of the awards, as well as we'll find out soon who won our head-to-head. But plenty of interesting facts from the tournament this week. There was so much quality again that by listener demand, we're doing another top 10. Are you ready for me to fire away, BIG?
Yeah, let's get right into it.
Number 10, the Brazilian who scored two sensational goals, surely nominated for the goal of a tournament, gets a new tattoo featuring Ronaldo, Neymar, as well as a young and current version of himself. Is that to remind him of the players who've delivered a World Cup for the Samba Kings?
Yeah, I don't know. It's a strange one, isn't it? You know, Richarlison getting a tattoo of perhaps your idol. I can understand that, but to have yourself up there with him, maybe he rates himself that highly. But for him to put himself into that category, I think he's got to go on and maybe win a World Cup now.
I think he's a bit ahead of himself. I love him. He's a Spurs player, and he had a good World Cup. No, I wouldn't say great. He scored two cracking goals, but he didn't deliver anything for Brazil. But yeah, like I said, to put yourself in the same realms, especially as R9 or Neymar, he's going to on his legs. He's going to get Roberto Carlos and Zico and all these sorts of people alongside himself.
I don't know. Yeah, like I said, it's a strange one, but he obviously does rate himself. He's got the number 9 for Brazil, so you know you've got to have a little bit of faith in yourself if you're wearing that jersey. It's you know you got to have broad shoulders and big boots to fill the R9. So we saw it in glimpses this World Cup, and it's a shame we didn't get to see more. It would have been nice if they you know a semi final between Brazil and Argentina, I think would have been a real good spectacle.
Good luck, Richarlison, with that tattoo Hall of Fame. Number 9, the final was played between the only two teams that beat the Socceroos. France won the group and Argentina ended Australia's hopes in the round of 16.
Yeah, look, it's always good when the team that knocks you out goes on to win the tournament and another team that beats you goes on to play in the final. So it happened in 2006 with Italy going all the way. So you know, maybe we don't want to make this a recurring theme for the Socceroos, but it's good that we got out of the group and it's great that we're facing, you know, the best teams in the world and, you know, let that continue. And we want to be playing against the best and we want to be playing in World Cups. We want to be playing in World Cup, knockout matches. So, you know, it's great for Australian sport and great for Australian football to be playing those games. But, you know, hopefully we don't get the curse every World Cup knockout match from now on. The winner goes on to lift the trophy, and we're packing our bags going home. Maybe we can knock one of these bigger nations off.
I was going to say we don't want it to be the Mario Balotelli, why always me, right? We don't. It's nice to hear those stories about how I could have, would have, and should have, but we want to be the team that went and knocked them out, and someone else has to tell the story about how the Socceroos fits into their funny story of getting knocked out. We don't want to be the ones telling the funny stories all the time.
Absolutely.
All right, number 8, England's first World Cup with zero arrests. The brave Three Lions at least have the fans coming home.
I'll tell you what, you'd probably arrest a couple of their players, wouldn't you? probably. No. Look, England had another, you know, a good tournament, but with the caliber of players they had, you know, I think they'll be kicking themselves that they didn't get a little bit more out of it, potentially make a semi-final or even a final. But, you know, when you're up against a world-class team like France, so be it. But, yeah, the fans, I don't know, maybe not many of them travelled. I don't know. The only arrest that I know is I think Raheem Sterling had to go back to England to arrest the thugs that were tried to, you know, broke into his house. So apart from that, But yeah, look, maybe the no alcohol and you know, finding it hard to find alcohol in Qatar and at the stadiums, at the grounds, you know, maybe that played a part as well.
Maybe that's something that the other host nations need to look at in the future, because usually the English aren't well behaved. So if they have had a good tournament and they've also, you know, stayed out of trouble, then that's good news for the English. But I'm probably on a final note just thinking maybe Gareth Southgate has either a few, he's a godparent of a few of these people, or maybe he's got a few things on them because of the fact that everyone keeps saying he deserves more, longer and more chances. I look at Argentina coach, the Morocco coach, the list goes on. These guys have delivered. He still hasn't delivered. And as we said, he's got a fantastic playing squad. So how many chances do you get? He's got nine lives, does he?
He does. Apparently he's got one more chance. So he's got until the Euros in 2024 to try and deliver some silverware. So we'll see what happens. But
we'll be talking about him a little bit longer.
They keep falling short, don't they?
Number seven, Karim Benzema stated, "I'm not interested," apparently as he was invited by the president of France to attend but declined the offer. So no Ballon d'Or winner on or off the pitch. Surely he had better things to do.
Yeah, look, I'm sure he did have better things to do than sit with the president. But, yeah, look, a little bit disappointing in Benzema, I think. You know, a player that I understand it's heartbreaking for him to miss a World Cup and to have to step away from the squad to go back and do his rehab. But, you know, you saw what, you know, Kun Aguero did to the Argentina squad, just having him around and lifting the mood. You know, I thought maybe Benzema, you know, I understand he's gone away for a little bit, but once he's come back, maybe, you know, it would have been good to have him in and around the squad and you know, in with the team. But, you know, we've said it for years. He doesn't always fit into that French squad, and sometimes it's a shame because he's a tremendous footballer. I think one of the all-time great strikers in world football, and he's at the peak of his powers at the moment. And for him to miss out on the World Cup and to not really fit in with his French team, it's quite disappointing.
Look, he could have taken one at least for the team. If he'd been there, the French president would have had someone else to cuddle instead of Mbappe. So instead of chasing him around for the whole 80 minutes after the game finished, trying to cuddle him and give him words of encouragement, maybe if Benzema had been there and he hadn't played, maybe, like I said, he could have split his time between the Ballon d'Or winner as well as the Golden Boot winner.
Yeah, look, I think Mbappe's got half his ears chewed off, so... the poor bloke. He's also scored a hat trick in a World Cup final and lost. So very rare. He had a tremendous game. He's a freak of a talent. And you know, the best thing about killing Mbappe is that he's going to be around for many more World Cups to come.
He was probably whispering to his PSG teammate Messi, "Can you pass me that invisible cloak?"
It's like, can I just borrow it? Look, Messi dropped it on stage somewhere, so I'm sure he could have gone and picked it up.
All right, number six. Thank you, Martin Tyler, for taking football fans on another amazing journey during the tournament. The best in the business wrapping up his 12th World Cup, but at 77, what will they do when David Attenborough of football chooses to hang up the microphone? They're in big trouble.
Oh, they're in big trouble. I don't know. I think, look, he's given us so many great moments in football, and obviously that Aguero goal in the Premier League when Man City won the title. Phenomenal, you know. As an Australian growing up, we've heard his voice for a long, long time now. But yeah, I don't know. I don't know if his glasses were fogging up or if he couldn't see through them half the time, because at one stage in the final, he was calling Alex McAllister Messi. So I don't know. I know McAllister had a phenomenal tournament, and he's a great player. He's going to be hot on the transfer market now, and Brighton are going to find it very hard to keep a hold of him. But you know, he was miscalling a few. Poor old Martin Tyler was miscalling a few players, and you know, when I look at some of the Spanish commentary for the goal, for the penalties that won it, you know, it's chalk and cheese. You know, Martin Tyler, he's a great servant of the game, great voice of the game. But yeah, he's going to be missed. But you know, maybe we should have moved on a little bit sooner.
Mate, he's about 10 lengths ahead of the rest of the field. So even if he's making a couple of mistakes here or there, it just closes the field slightly, ever so slightly. So he wins by 11 lengths instead of 12. But he's he's absolutely brilliant. And who knows? Look, maybe he goes on to his 81st birthday, or depending when his birthday is, maybe he goes on and does his 13th. His unlucky 13th. But he definitely is a one of a kind. Number five, Didier Deschamps unfortunately fell just short of becoming only the second coach ever to have won the World Cup twice, the first being Vittorio Pozzo with Italy in 1934 and 38, who's the only one, a long, long time ago. He is, however, only one of three men to have won it as a player and a coach. Add to that, Argentina coach Scalini did an amazing job as the youngest coach at Qatar, only 44 years of age, the closest to him being Cameroon's coach at 46. But he's still a few years older than the Uruguayan Albert Supi, who recorded a win in 1930 at the age of only 30. You are kidding.
Yeah, that is ridiculous. That is ridiculous.
30 is too young to be playing. Is still young to be playing, let alone coaching.
It is. And look, I think Scaloni went and picked up his he put on his jersey from, I think it was the 94 World Cup. And put that on to go out and lift a trophy at the end. So, you know, phenomenal as a player to play in a World Cup one and then to go and win it as a coach at 44 years old is phenomenal achievement.
Absolutely wonderful. Number four, FIFA president Gianni Infantino wearing probably a very expensive suit but matching it with Jerry Seinfeld's sparkling white sneakers. Nice kicks, but presenting the awards in front of a global audience of over a billion viewers. Did one of the regions not make their payment on time? What's the reason behind the white sneakers?
God, I don't know. It depends how he felt today. How did he – today he felt young, I think, and he just wanted to wear his white sneakers with his suit.
He felt sporty. He felt sporty today. He's worn it a few times during the tournament, though, so it's not the first time he's had the old white kicks out. But, you just think that you'd be able to pair your $300,000 suit with something a little bit classier than a pair of kids' white sneakers, wouldn't you?
Yeah, look, I don't know. He's trying to stay fashionable, trying to stay in the game, and you know, he's a man of many, and you know, today he just felt young and a bit sporty.
All right, number three. Excuse the pronunciation. Croatia's Josko Gvardiol, is that correct? Yeah, he's a great young talent with his price rising as high as 100 million with his performances at the World Cup, but he's definitely no goat herder as Messi tied him in knots in the semi-final.
Look, phenomenal goal. Let's be honest, I don't think he did that much wrong as a defender.
He showed that he's never going to round up the goats, right?
No, 100%.
The goats are in the paddock, they're going to stay out there eating the grass all day because there's no way he might be able to use the man in the eye mask as a slight excuse because maybe his vision was a bit impaired or it affected some of his senses. But let me tell you, the goat had him in the bag.
He did. He got absolutely turned inside out. But a bit of support from his teammates wouldn't have gone astray. You know, he might be able to herd a flock of sheep, but when you're trying to herd a goat, you know, maybe you need a few extra pairs of hands. But look, he had a phenomenal tournament. He's a great young talent, a great centre back. But when you're coming up against, you know, the best player in the world, or arguably the greatest player of all time now after winning the World Cup, you know, it's difficult to stop him. And Messi and Argentina, they're on a mission to win this World Cup, and that goal in the semi final was just phenomenal.
Gvardiol has got a huge future ahead, and it'll be very interesting over the coming months to see where he ends up. But we know one thing for sure: if we asked him what's a herd of goats called, I don't think he'd know the answer.
still looking for one.
Yeah, he's still looking for one. And number two, Croatia's players' children celebrating on the pitch as they won the bronze.
Yeah, that's you know, that's what football is about. It's about family, and you being able to share those moments with your family. And as a young parent myself, you know, being able to have your child on the football pitch with you, it's a special moment. And we saw how much it means to those players, and how much it means to the kids as well. That they're moments that they'll never forget. Growing up, being able to watch their dad play at a World Cup and being able to share the pitch with him, you know, it's what dreams are made of, and hopefully it inspires some of those kids to go on and play for Croatia. You know, no doubt, you know, knowing Croatians and knowing their background and the way they care about football and family, and you know, there's no doubt that some of those younger boys, the sons of players at the moment, will, you know, potentially go on and also play for Croatia.
You've already ticked off a bucket list, right? You've already been on a field at the World Cup at the young age of, you know, under 10, which a lot of these kids were. There was also a classic moment there where two of the kids were running around. I think one of the little girls wasn't watching and she ran up the back of one of the other children and knocked him to the ground. I think that would have been come in handy in the semi-finals when they were having a lot of trouble trying to tag the dangerous attacking force. But maybe next time they can come in on some of the set-piece trainings.
They could put her on Messi to track Messi around.
Oh, yeah, definitely. All right, and the number one for our final top 10 of the World Cup, Golden Ball winner, previously won by greats Maradona, Ronaldo, Zidane and Messi. Messi now makes it two, the first player ever to win the award twice. Sensational.
Yeah, phenomenal. Look, he had a phenomenal tournament. You know, goals, yes, he scored a couple of penalties, but, you know, two goals in the final. He led that Argentina team from, you know, from start to finish. A little hiccup in the first game against Saudi, but we've seen it happen before with Spain losing their first game to Switzerland and going on to win the World Cup. But look, for me, I think now the debate is over. The Ronaldo Messi debate is over. Messi winning a World Cup now. He's done things this tournament that I honestly didn't expect him to do after the couple of years he's had at PSG since leaving Barcelona. And I thought perhaps he was maybe on a decline, but he's gone out and proven everyone wrong. He's been phenomenal. He's scored goals. He's assisted goals. He's you know, that assist in the semi final. That's a moment that'll go down in World Cup history. And I'm just happy for him. I think he's a phenomenal player that I've been fortunate enough to watch his whole career. And it's, you know, right now I couldn't be more happy for him. And that's coming from myself. I'm a Man United fan, a huge Cristiano Ronaldo fan. I think Ronaldo is a phenomenal player, phenomenal goal scorer, phenomenal talent, phenomenal athlete. But Messi can do things on a football pitch that no other human can do, and no other human is even remotely capable of doing. I think he's a phenomenal player, once in a lifetime player, and you know, it was a special moment to when we look back on this in 10, 20, 30 years time. You know, you're going to be telling your grandkids and their kids about Lionel Messi and him winning the World Cup for Argentina in 2022 in Qatar. So phenomenal achievement. I think it's a cherry on top for his career. And you know, he's probably, I don't know, maybe I'm talking letting emotions and the day, I suppose, you know, get on top of me. But
no sleep.
He and no sleep, yeah, he could be you know, the greatest footballer of all time.
Yeah, look, I think exclamation mark there too is, you know, everyone expected that it was his last game. If you believe the rumours, he said he will still wear the Argentina jersey because he'd love to go out and represent them, you know, as world champions. So I don't know what that means, whether he's going to play some friendlies, whether he's going to play Copa America, whether he's going to play, you know, World Cup qualifiers. I don't know what that means, but he's not the only one to have backflipped. Looked like Ronaldo was going to hang the boots up. He's going to probably try and go for the next Euros. I think Modric said he's having too great a time representing his beloved Croatia. So I don't know how many of these guys. I think the only one that's actually kept to it is Busquets, and he's the youngest of them. He's 34, and he's decided at 143 caps or whatever, he's had enough. But the others, maybe watching Messi's success and him wanting to continue, maybe that's egging them on as well. But yeah, look, a lot of interesting things to come ahead in football, and I think we're running very short on time. So what we might do next week is touch on things like who we think was the young player of the World Cup, as well as what's the most disappointing team, etc. But let's get into our final Pele Awards. So our spin on the 1995 American comedy Kicking and Screaming, starring Will Ferrell and Robert Duvall. Footage explaining more in the full video show.
If I win, what? I get the Pele ball.
What?
I beat you in the finals? Pele ball. It's mine. I give it.
Here comes Pele!
I get the Pele ball.
In last week's awards, the listeners voted and Team Geo won the decider in a tough game, giving him an overall 2-1 victory. Well played, lads. I'd like to thank my sponsors and my opponent. Well done, VIG. It was a lot of fun.
Thank you, and congratulations. It was a lot of fun, and you know, it made watching the football a little bit more enjoyable.
All right, so let's get stuck into these, and I think we'll just take out. We can do some alternates here, or we can do this as a combo. So our best goal, the double Ronnie. So there was a few nominations here. I think Richarlison's team goal was excellent. Casemiro's half volley was fantastic. I know you were also a massive fan of Neymar's. You told me when you were pitching that it was going to be one of the classic goals of all time. I know you're also...
I put some sauce on it, didn't I? And no, I still honestly, I think.
Oh, yeah, it was back, a pig with lipstick on it.
In the context of the game, if that was the winner, if that was the match winner, I think we'd all be sitting here now with potentially, you know, we would have seen a semi final with Argentina and Brazil, which would have been a phenomenal game, and we would have been talking about Neymar's goal and that winner in the quarter final. Unfortunately, Brazil got knocked out by penalties and lost to Croatia. So maybe that takes a bit of shine off it, but I still think that's a phenomenal goal. But I think we've come to agreement that
Richarlison is the best goal of a double Ronnie of the World Cup in Qatar.
Yeah, look, he is the R9. He's the new R9, Richarlison, and his goal against Serbia, that volley on the turn that he did right at the beginning of the tournament. So after that goal, you're thinking Brazil, you know, we both picked Brazil to go on and make the final. But we're thinking, you know, Brazil are a real chancy after their performance at the start. But, you know, World Cups aren't won in after the first fixture. They're won after the seventh or eighth. So, you know, disappointing that Brazil didn't go further and deeper in the tournament. But Richarlison takes our double Ronnie Award.
And the bonus for all Spurs fans like myself is he's out for 6 weeks after hurting his hamstring in the warm-up against Croatia. So not only do they get knocked out and not give their country any joy, but he's also now 6 weeks missing for Tottenham when we really need him. So,
I think he's just gone on a holiday back to Brazil. I think it's summer down here now. So, you know, he doesn't want to go back to cold, old, miserable London and miserable Spurs. I think he's gone to some beach in Brazil.
His new tattoo, a chance to just settle.
Just a heel, yeah.
All right, so moving on to our best save, also known as our Safe as a Banks, which was a tribute to England legend goalkeeper Gordon Banks. So I think there was plenty of you know, contenders for this one. So we were always early on, especially in the group games, you know, very, very pleased, I suppose, or happy with some of the work that Szczesny was doing for Poland. You were talking up Croatia's Livakovic, who you thought was unstoppable and you thought was going to be the keeper of the tournament. There was also Bono, who can forget Bono for his amazing goalkeeping exploits with the surprise packet of the World Cup Morocco. So there was lots of contenders in there. It was probably a dozen keepers. I know Alisson pulled off a few fantastic saves as well as the Japanese keeper. But there was one from this morning's final that we just couldn't go past. So who's going to take out our best save, Safe as a Banks Award, VIG?
Yeah, look, it's pipped it. And Emi Martinez this morning in extra time, his save against Kolo Muani. You know, God, where Kolo Muani hits that, he probably thinks, I've just won the World Cup for my country, for France. But it's a great save down to his left with his foot. And given the circumstances, the timing of the, I think it was in the 118th minute, 2 minutes to go in extra time. Given the timing and the importance, we're going to pip all previous nominations. And we've agreed to give it to Emi Martinez with Safe of the Tournament, Safe as the Banks.
Mate, very while it's super exciting for Emi Martinez, it's disappointing for Kolo Muani because he was already looking at having a Disney movie named after him, Kolo Muani, and he's going to end up with Nani now. He's going to end up with nothing. So, unfortunately, he's going to go back to his club team so close yet so far, but absolutely fantastic save. And after everything he's been through, Martinez, it goes to show that hard work can pay off.
Yeah, definitely. And he's a massive, massive reason why Argentina lifted the cup. And, you know, as big as Messi is and the exploits that he's shown, Martinez was a huge part of that. And you saw what he did when he came in. They won the Copa and now they've won the World Cup. So they've got the double and he's been the keeper in both. And he's a massive personality in that squad.
Moving on to our third award, which is something outrageous, our Maradona kebab, which probably carries a little bit more sentiment now, the fact that Argentina and the famous number 10 shirt was victorious in holding aloft the Holy Grail and taking the trophy back to South America and back to the football-mad Argentina. So there was a few great nominations there. Unfortunately, Morocco's seven clean sheets came to an end and ended up not quite enough, but it still didn't take away from the fact that their journey was amazing. And it was not only amazing on the pitch, but watching how close they were with their family and how far, you know, how far an African team has gone in the World Cup was just fantastic to watch. There was also Luis Enrique's team's pass the parcel. So everyone wanting to pass the ball, but no one wanting to shoot the ball. And unfortunately for him, the rules of the games are that goals are 99% of the rules, right? So if you don't score goals, you can't win games. So unfortunately for Luis Enrique, he's fallen on his sword and his team's fallen on their passes. And it wasn't enough to get them through to the business end of the World Cup, but it's also not good enough for to get them to the top of the pops for the Maradona Kebab Award. But the one we're going for, we just couldn't believe, and it could only happen at a World Cup like this where the fairy tale has been cut short because of one person's probably incompetence, which he won't back down from. So what's our winning nomination for the Something Outrageous Maradona Kebab Award, VIG?
Yeah, our winning nomination is Sanchez, the Portuguese coach, playing Gonzalo over our boy Ronaldo. And then leaving him out. So he's brought him into the squad. Outrageous, right, decision to leave Ronaldo on the bench. He's brought him in, and Gonzalo Ramos has scored a hat-trick against Switzerland.
And albeit to only four goals, though, to four goals for the country.
Four goals, yeah. You know, so in his first World Cup start, he scored a hat-trick. It's great. There's a lot of, you know, phenomenon around this young striker that plays for Benfica. He's a good young player, but you're leaving one of the greatest of all time, Cristiano Ronaldo, on the bench, and to leave him out against Morocco, it's can't come back to bite Sanchez on the backside, and it's cost him his job as Portugal coach, and it's probably potentially cost us the fans a final potentially that's involving Messi up against Ronaldo, the ultimate showdown for the greatest of all time.
With his eyesight. He went to write CR7. He wrote GR7 on the sheet. Is that could have been a problem? The eyesight gets as you get older, your eyesight fades, right? So maybe it was just a typo.
Maybe it was. Maybe it was an honest mistake. But you know, honestly, what was he thinking?
Surely you come out and say to the media afterwards, the dumbest thing I've ever done. It's cost me my job. It's cost Portugal probably a spot in the final and a showdown for Messi and Ronaldo to once and for all decide who is the king. But, yeah, he's walked away eating humble pie and he's cost his country any opportunity. So the winner of our Maradona Kebab Award is the Portuguese coach for his foolishness, thinking that GR7 was the man to take them to the finals over CR7.
That's it. And he'll be off. Only thing he'll be able to afford is a kebab now.
Okay. Moving on to our fourth and our second last award, only in Qatar, different time of year, no beer, something you can only see here. So this one was looked like it was going to be a really straightforward decision for us. I think you pitched in week one of our nominations, Stadium 974, which didn't meet any security or any HR or compliance checks with 974 storage containers stacked on top of each other. I would have been worried if I had two stacked on it and it started to move in the wind, let alone 974 stacked temporarily, which was being pulled down before the knockout stages even started. But something's come ahead and jumped the gun on that, and which we both just thought was just something that unfortunately we just couldn't give up and couldn't not nominate and not give the award to. So our only in Qatar award winner is Messi's invisible cloak. Unfortunately, it didn't make FIFA or Infantino disappear, but it gave him some great photos in his lingerie, which I'm sure he'll look back on as great memorabilia when he looks back on this wonderful achievement at the World Cup 22 in Qatar.
Yeah, look, what were they thinking? I don't know. Like, we're going to look at these images in 10, 15, 20 years' time. These are the most, this is going to be one of the most iconic images in world football. Lionel Messi lifting the trophy for Argentina, and he's got this lingerie cloak on. Like, I'm sure the other boys in the team were just having a giggle going, what is going on here? Because I was looking at that going, surely he's not going to wear that all the way to lift the trophy. And, yep, he did. And, you know, it looked a bit strange. But, you know, like we've said all tournament, only these things happen in Qatar. So, you know, we've said all along we need to embrace their culture. And, respect what they do, and you know, I suppose that's what Messi was doing. He was paying the ultimate respect to FIFA and Qatar, and him lifting the trophy in the invisibility cloak or the lingerie. Honestly, I don't know if I could have done it. I think I would have told him to go do one, and I would have taken it off before I lifted the trophy. But that's just me personally. But Messi's just too nice, isn't he? He's too nice a bloke.
This close to Christmas, they might have done him a favour, because when you look at him and his wife, you might think, what do you give someone for Christmas that has everything? Well, now he's got something. He's able to give her this invisible lingerie cloak that he was able to hold the World Cup in on a national stage in front of a billion people. Now, I don't know if you could come up with a better gift than that. If in your wildest imagination, you couldn't come up with something as out there as that. And that's all thanks to the hosts in Qatar, as well as the lads at FIFA.
Yeah, look, I hope he did give it to his missus, and I hope she did put it on tonight for him.
Okay, moving on to our last award, which is our VAR-VAR-NA, our VAR and officiating stuff-ups. There was plenty of them, but I think we just skate past this as quickly as we can. Morocco's, the handball in Morocco's defeat in the 85th minute when they were down 1-0 was pretty poor. I think there was some others along the way where we were saying that the thickness of a shirt, the Japanese striker was given offside, they're not offside, and so on. So there was a lot of decisions. I think there was one as early on. This was probably setting the pace when Ecuador had a goal disallowed after 5 minutes, which, you know, the more you look at it, the more you couldn't give it offside or even disallow goal, the more they gave it offside and no goal. So for us, but there's just one that it comes down to, and I think he's won nothing at the World Cup. He's lost his job, but I think he's probably made a few, Germany enemies happy. So who's our winner of the VAR-VAR-NA award for the World Cup Qatar 2022?
Yeah, so the winner goes to the Japan and Japan-Spain game. The ball's crossed the line. Look, there's daylight between the line and the ball, right? So how I don't know. I find this rule to be absolutely ridiculous. Looking at it from a bird's eye view, you know, is a little bit of the ball still over the line? Look, if you can see grass between the ball and the line, it's out. The ball's out. That's for me. That's
the ball was in Japan.
The ball was in Tokyo, and I'll tell you what, Japan, they're going to change their national flag and add a line next to the ball for it. But yeah, look, I don't know. I'm not a fan of this rule, because you can't apply this rule to every football match in the world, right? So, you know, there's not VAR and technology at youth level or you know, Sunday league football. Like, if the ball is over the line and you can see grass between the line and the ball's out. That's what it's always been. That's what I've always been told. That's what every linesman has officiated like that, you know, for the ages of time. So why they've gone and changed it now to, you know, you got to be up like a pterodactyl flying over the pitch to see where the ball is, to see if it's in or out, or if there's a little bit hovering over the line. I don't know. For me, use the technology. The ball's out. It's over the line. And that's it.
I hope you're sitting down, but this is a amazing technology that I've come up with, eyeballs. That's
right.
As long as you've got eyeballs, right, you can just sit there and look. A lot of these ones, you don't need, like you said, you don't need vision from the moon. You don't need, you know, overhead jets. You can just look at it and go, oh, hang on a sec. I can see space between the line and the ball, which means no matter how I look at it, the ball is out, right? The ball's out. At the end of the day, it just means now that FIFA will be getting a Christmas card from Germany, and inside it will say, I owe you, or you owe me, $19 million, because costing them a spot in the knockout phase cost the German Football Federation $19 million, quite a costly mistake for them. But look, we know the VAR as well as the officials are doing the best they can. I thought the referee in the final had a really good game, so goes to show that humans can do a really great job, even under huge pressure and big circumstances. Six goals in a fantastic final with a lot of pressure. You know, obviously a lot of the world wanting Messi to go out a winner. You know, obviously France have got a one-man army there in the guy called Mbappe, who scored a hat-trick and did everything he could, including another penalty, so scoring four goals in the game to try and carry his team home. So lots of pressure on you in a huge atmosphere with a huge crowd, and he did a fantastic job. So I don't want to listen to the rubbish anymore about, you know, it was a tough situation, or the guy was trying to watch Netflix at the same time as he's reviewing the VAR thing. Just get it right.
Yeah, I agree. The referee in the final did a tremendous job, and I think it was Taram who went down in the box, sort of left his leg hanging and dived a little bit. He was looking for contact but didn't get it and went down. And for the referee to pull that up straight away and issue a yellow card for simulation, I thought that was a great call. And I think the other penalties, I think the handball is unfortunate at the end, but I think he's got it right. The hand was away from the body. It's made contact with the ball, and we've seen them given as penalties all season and pretty much since the VAR's come in. So
that could be the newest version of the hand of God, right? It wasn't a Maradona intentional, but it's helped the Argentinian new god to get a World Cup that he totally deserves. So if you're ever going to get the decision, which is a little bit grey, you want it to be in the favour of a good guy like Messi, who has been unbelievable for the sport. So, look, congratulations to all our winners of our Pele Awards. It's been fantastic bringing it to you. We'll be a bit sad next week or the week after, whenever we're back on air, that we won't have those awards, but there'll be plenty of other fantastic entertainment and segments for you to enjoy. But up now is just our final stretch, is our clinical finish. So our What the Foot Award, let's quickly get through this. Argentina's World Cup shootout hero, keeper Emilio Martinez, we've talked about at great lengths. His penalty saves, he's trash-talking everything, but his obscene gesture when accepting the Golden Glove Award, what the foot. He won't be looking at it. And when you look at it, you think maybe he's a young keeper. He's 30 years of age. You should know better. What was he doing? And then he puts it to his mouth like he's doing, I don't know, Dr. Evil. And it was just absolutely, whoever wrote that script for him, they should have burnt it.
Yeah, I don't know what to say about that. That was, just weird, just very strange watching that. I don't know. I think that the trophy presentations took so long after the final whistle. I think the players had gone inside to the sheds and probably had a laugh, and he was obviously on a bit of a high, and we all know what goalkeepers are like. They're strange cats, and they do strange things sometimes. And that was very strange. I don't know who the gesture was for or what it was about, but maybe in the next coming days we'll get an explanation from him. But
I'm glad it wasn't for me.
What the foot? Oh, I'm hoping it wasn't for me as well.
All right, so games to watch this week. Back so soon, another F3 derby that postponed. I think it was round one on Wednesday. Sydney versus the Bulls on Saturday, and then the Melbourne Derby, Western United hosting Victory on Boxing Day. So plenty of great football coming up. Let's hope that the football does the talking over the next week or so. We don't have any more of this, off-field chaos that's, brought the game into disrepute and taken away from the major thing, which is football and the game we all love.
Yeah, definitely. And look, we saw with the World Cup, there was plenty of talk before the event had started, and plenty of people with their political say in what's right and what's wrong and all these things. But once the football started, that's what we're all here to watch. We love the game, and once it started, the football did the talking, and that's all we were talking about, and the rest took care of itself. So all in all, it was a tremendous tournament. Some great football played, and some tremendous matches and some tremendous individual performances, capped off with Argentina and Messi winning the World Cup. And that's all we want to see back here in the A-League. We want to see football played week in, week out. We want to be talking about football. That's what we love to do. That's why we do this podcast, because we love talking about football with each other, with our mates. Let the football do the talking, and let the players enjoy themselves, go out there. Let's support the players. Let's get behind them. And, really enjoy ourselves over this Christmas period.
Absolutely. We've got two fantastic competitions up and running at the moment. And like I said, they're only overlapped the last 2 weeks, but there's been plenty of great football from the women's, and the men's is back, been back on 2 weeks now. So let's just get behind them. But quick TFR fantasy update, as weird as it is. So last week, VIG with a ton took the lead back off me. So let's see if you can back it up this week. But with the disaster that happened in Melbourne, and this is the least of their worries, is our TFR fantasy. But so many players got wiped out and the game hasn't actually been counted as an official game. I don't think it's been a complete round. So we were both waiting for our email from Keeping Up Fantasy, and there was nothing. So we've had to go in there and test our mathematical skills and manually do this. So my round 8 score was 53, but I think it's incomplete. But it's the same for both of us. So my total is now 590. Yours, VIG, was how many?
43, I think. So my total is
582.
There we go.
Oh, I've gone back to front by 8, but I think it's an incomplete round. I think we both had the disadvantage. But
I'm not calling it. I'm not calling it a round yet until it's complete. So I've still got a few players to play. Hopefully we see the Melbourne Derby completed at some stage. But yeah.
All right. If you missed any part of the show or want to listen to the other episodes, where can they catch it?
Yeah, they can catch us on all good podcast platforms, Spotify, Apple, Google Podcasts, Football Nation Radio, and also on our YouTube channel.
Yeah, so Football Nation Radio on Monday nights at 9 p.m. YouTube channel, there's plenty of great footage at the moment. So we're staying away from the video footage that keeps getting taken back off us. So we're just sticking with still photos, but there's still plenty on there. There's plenty of music for our shout out of the week, as well as some other cool photos. There's plenty of men's and women's A-League action coming up, as well as a little rest now that the World Cup has finished. We are taking a two-week break over the festive season, so Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to you and your families. I hope you've enjoyed the show even half as much as we've enjoyed bringing it to you. We'll see you again in 2023, and until then, all the best. And as we say, rise up, join the football revolution, have a great and safe Christmas and New Year, and we'll catch you again next year.